Open in Hawaii. You're making your fifth appearance at this event, first since 2019. Can you just start with your thoughts on being back here?
Yeah, I think, you know, I was either here or San Diego for me, and I love both tournaments. San Diego has kind of seemed easier in the West Coast stretch, but I can't seem to figure out how to make the cut in January there. So, and I've always really liked this golf course. It's just been more about how much to play on the West Coast. And so this year it was an easy decision before a couple weeks off, before a pretty busy stretch after. So I like this place. You got to think your way around it. It's kind of, they've got a bit of colonial feel for me. And it's still different than that, but kind of a similar feel to the way Hilton Head and Colonial, you have to plot your way around and, you know, pick and choose times to be aggressive. And plays very different from last week while you're only, you know, a 30-minute flight over. So it's got a great history as well at this event. And I've played it well in the past. 2017, I think I finished third. So try and draw off of maybe memories from that week and try and improve from last week as well.
Okay. Speaking of last week at the Century Tournament of Champions, what was your takeaway? What did you build off from that coming into this week?
Yeah, I shook a little bit of rust off. Luckily, I played in December a couple times, but I always love that event. I mean, it's one that, every time after you win, it's like the first thing you think about is, like, can I start booking my trip to Maui? And that'll never change for me. I just really enjoy going down there and playing that tournament. So when it's over, it's kind of sad, but it's nice to come over here and still be in Hawaii and play another one.
All right. Then we'll open up to the group. Cam?
Hugely different from last week to this week. And last week, obviously, you won there at that course. But this week, you say you played well as well. Also, do you have a certain type of course that you prefer, or at this point you can just win on any of them?
I think that I think I prefer the bigger, slopier feel courses like Augusta and Kapalua, but you know, Colonial is probably my most successful tournament as far as finishes in the top 10 per times playing it, if you want to put it that way, as far as form at a course. So it's kind of odd. I love sometimes how trees shape shots, like Hilton Head has a ton of that. I don't necessarily love when driver's taken out of your hands on courses, but that happens at those few that I've mentioned here and Colonial and Hilton Head. So I'm not sure. I would say I prefer and enjoy playing those uneven lie, you know, in the wind, you know, field type golf courses more. But there's been a few places that are quite the opposite that I've been able to have success at. So, yeah, I think that answers that. Yeah.
What do you think you'll be doing in the fall?
I'll still want to play periodically a couple times. I won't be good at taking, you know, if I have the chance, I wouldn't be good at taking 5 months of no tournament golf. Maybe look at some opportunities like going back to Australia. I really loved going there, and I haven't gone there since 2017. So maybe a couple overseas type overseas tournaments that may come up that I hadn't really been able to go to since pre-COVID. Other than that, football games, being a dad, it'd be pretty easy to fill time now, easier than when I was, you know, not married and no kids. You know, now you get that time to just be home.
But the point is, do you think other people would be like you? You'll still play.
I think I'll still play. I mean, this year I played one FedEx Cup event from East Lake until last week. So I didn't really. And then, you know, I played Tiger's event and the father-son. And so I would imagine it'd be a similar type schedule where I'd try to play more Thanksgiving into December than earlier in the fall. Take that like 6-8 week break and then try and play and then play a little closer to when the season starts, because it'll be so important to be off to a good start in Maui, more so than, well, it's been that way for me because I haven't played much in the fall, but more than other years.
And secondly, 4 looks like in terms of size of field, whatever gets determined. How important do you think it is to have a cut?
I've bounced back and forth. I'm kind of either way. I think that there's an argument to be said that if you have the ability to not, then you're guaranteed, you know, that kid that came out and Justin Thomas is his favorite player. And Justin...
That one kid, right.
Okay. The vast thousands of kids that have Justin Thomas as their favorite player. You know, not that he misses a lot of cuts, but one week, you know, say you were to even cut it on a Saturday and cut 10 or 15 guys out to be able to go twos or whatever, I don't know,
sure,
random times before daylight savings. You know, guaranteeing that, you know, they have baseball games or baseball tournament on Saturday, the only day they can go is Sunday. Guaranteeing that you're going to be able to see your favorite player play, regardless if they have a chance to win that day or not. See, that's the part where I'm like, it'd be kind of nice to be able to, you know, have that opportunity for fans. But at the same time, I think that the professional golf that we've been playing for all this time, I mean, I would, you know, 80% of the tournaments that I've played in, maybe more, have had cuts, and you've got to play well, and that's part of when you're off, the fight to not mail it in and to try and work your way into making that cut. So I'm either way, I'm indifferent on it, but I've been stronger on one side or the other at different time periods. But when it comes to the argument of cut for world ranking points or whatever, and obviously the conversation with Liv, I don't think that we should be doing something. We should be doing what's best for our tour and forget about the consequences of and any reaction that would cause elsewhere.
Does Jordan Spieth, the board member, and Jordan Spieth, the player, have different thoughts or different ideas when you're in those meetings?
I think that, and I haven't been a board member now for well over a year, but to answer your question on the way it was when I was, I would say that you're representing the entire membership. You're representing number one on the FedEx, and you're representing number 200, and you're representing the guy with medical status. And you have to throw out where your position is, regardless of if you're playing poorly, you want to help positions that you're in. If you're playing well, you only want to help top guys. You just have to be, you have to look out for the membership and really maybe the future of the PGA Tour, and that doesn't necessarily mean helping certain guys or others, but it might if the product's going to be better one way or the other. So you have to be somewhat objective versus when I'm out playing myself, being like, man, I wish this was this way. That would help me. So, yeah, a little bit.
We were talking to Adam Scott, and we're all different things, world rankings, points in the system, and everything else. But one of the things that came up is the idea of potentially changing the 18% rule in regards to the winner's check to a larger number, maybe proportionally different depending on the field and how tough the field is, like the world ranking points are supposed to be. Would you be in favor of something like that?
I hadn't really thought about that on the winner's cut. If so, then not by much, but certainly having it, I mean, winning is winning. It is very different. I mean, second and fourth feels pretty similar. Third and sixth feels very similar. Winning feels very different. So if that percentage were to go up a couple points, I wouldn't be opposed to that at all. If it aligned with a world ranking system that got adjusted to like a strokes gain system where somehow got aligned in what could be changed going forward on the world ranking, then maybe that would be the best way to do it.
What about 40%?
No, I don't think
Adam brought that number up.
I mean, I just don't like
too big.
I just think that our sport, as much as I just said, it's so different winning and like second and fourth, like it could be a bit frustrating where you could finish second but have outplayed first significantly because of the draw you're on. You hit a pin in the ball. I mean, there's just so much in our sport that can be affected that the difference in it being 20%, and I don't know what second place is.
12,
I think. 12? Yeah. So from 20 to 12 versus 18 to 12 versus 40 to 15,
yeah.
It seems like that's too big of a spread for the way our sport works. It's not always an even playing field. For four rounds.
I'm not trying to pin you down on a number, but I liked your explanation as to why you think it shouldn't be too big of a change.
Yeah, I think there should be as much emphasis on winning as possible, and there's no bigger spread than between first and second. But I think that if you start to separate it so much, I just wonder, like, as we go forward here, I don't remember ever contending even my rookie year in an event and thinking about the difference in the money in first and second ever coming down the stretch. So does that add to it for the general public, like the fan watching on TV? Maybe. I mean, I guess. But you're still just looking at who wins. Like, you want to know who wins for the prestige of winning, not because of the difference in the paycheck until you get to the FedEx Cup. Then that's obviously, that's the bigger play. That's what's selling there. But that's tens of millions of dollars difference. I think that, you know, when you look at, I guess last week's probably a good way to look at it on how we're looking going forward with elevated events. There's a significant difference there in the money, enough to where someone might be thinking about it a little, and certainly the public is looking at it differently than when it was $1,700,000. Or 750 grand versus 2.7 to whatever second was.
1.5.
So it's, you know, almost double once you get up to whatever that number is, $25 million purse, it's like double, right? So I think if it were adjusted just minorly, because I've never, and I'm going back to rookie year, and I may be so wrong compared to other guys, but I don't remember ever being like, ooh, if I win this playoff, that's a difference in, I know exactly what that is, it's $700,000 difference. Like, why, like, that's the last thing you should be thinking about, I think, as a competitor.
But do you think that also is because of where you were, your financial situation?
That's why I mentioned this was rookie year. I remember thinking back that way.
But you still were probably taken care of. You had an Under Armour deal, you had a Timeless deal.
I mean, if I look at the people, I was in a playoff with Zach Johnson at the John Deere. I was not in the same financial situation as Zach Johnson. Well, I'm just saying, like, right. I guess it depends on who's in the group. But, I mean, in 14, I had chances to win and didn't, but it wasn't because I ever thought about that. I mean, I was with Bubba at the Masters and Martin Keimer at the Players and stuff like that. And those are big. Those are the biggest purses. And it was just about the prestige of the golf tournament versus the purse. But, again, as you're pointing out, that it may be a very different thought for somebody else.
Kind of along that thread and shifting over to points, as stupid as that seems, have you ever, I want to say it was 18, you came close to the Tour Championship.
31st.
Yeah. You've gone back and looked at the year when you mailed it in at the end of a round, tournament finishing 40th.
It's points you caught actually funny. I really didn't think about it, and something made me think about it the other day. And the tournament that stuck out to me that year was the Open Championship. I was in the final group on Sunday, and I played a really bad round. I played with Xander. I played a really poor round and a really bad finish to a round. A couple, like, ones that almost scooted a bunker and tipped in the back lip on, like, maybe 15, the par 4. That would have been a wedge, but it was a full-stroke penalty. And I finished ninth. And at a major with heightened points, if I finish eighth, I'm in the Tour Championship. And, like, that one stroke, you know, I don't care about it then because I'm trying to win the tournament. I'm trying to play aggressively.
Right.
And it probably cost me the Tour Championship playing aggressively versus playing the right way or playing a round that would – that if I wasn't going to win, I was going to finish sixth, you know, or one or two shots better. But I would never play that way, and it's just the way that cookie crumbled that year. I should have played better in the playoffs.
Sure.
But I don't.
Have you ever caught yourself mailing an email? Knowing what I mean by mailing an email. Quitting, but just not concentrating.
The only time I've ever. I would say there's been a few times where I've been enough out of the cut line where I couldn't make it with four or five to go. But in a tournament on Saturday or Sunday, I can't say that I've ever just not sat and picked a target and tried to hit the right shot. I don't think it ever had to do with the fact that it could affect some. I mean, I don't remember, like, afterwards I'd be like, yeah, this – I'm glad I didn't give up because that shot or two could mean something at the end. But in the process, it's just I just hate when the course beats me. I want to beat the golf course. I want to win that hole, you know.
I had a couple of this for you. Have you decided which elevated event you're skipping?
I have not. I have a tough schedule from Quail Hollow until Travelers. And so if I play Quail Hollow and Jack's event, then that's five in a row, which I've never done. Two of them are at home. But then it's 1 week off, then coast to coast, U.S. Open to Travelers. And so, I mean, it would be an easy decision if it weren't for the President's Cup last year. And now I'm going, maybe this... I've always wanted to play Quail Hollow, and it just always would be five in a row.
Is it Texas?
And now, and I just, I love Quail Hollow. And now that I kind of have, you know, the memories there from the last President's Cup, which I guess I'd have to go back and look at my scores and see if it was just like the matches or how much Justin helped or whatever to see if that would be useful.
He didn't help much on Saturday.
Well, he's... Yeah, he probably did on Thursday and Friday.
Yeah, that one kid out there watching.
Yeah, that one kid, yeah.
And I don't know yet, but it looks like it's either Quail Hollow or Travelers for me, which I like both, and that's tough. But I don't think I could skip Jack's event.
Are you still thinking about Tampa?
Yeah.
Would you consider Bay Hill?
No, I've played Bay Hill once and finished like fourth, so I think I got to probably, I played it in 2021 when Bryson won, and I finished, I had a chance on the weekend there, and, I played it once and finished fourth, and I love really difficult courses on Bermuda, and that's about as hard as it gets, and it's Bermuda.
And then lastly, you did the back nine today, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did you even notice that there's internal OB on 13? Par four that goes back toward the ocean. Really hard hole.
Yeah, the one that doglegs around the bunker. No, is it down the right side, right of the bunker?
Anything right?
I hit it right of the bunker, but I wasn't out of bounds. I wasn't right of the cart path.
Right of the red hazard area. It's constituted internal out of bounds. I was just trying to figure out why.
I appreciate. I would have never known. It would have never been a problem. Now I'm gonna be in the left rough 4 days.
Are you playing waste management?
I don't know why it would be like that.
Is there any advantage to 12? I mean, going down 12 fairway?
The green's so big that maybe the left pins, you'd be like, that fairway is so difficult to hit when you're hitting. You kind of have to hit driver there. And you just have to pinch it around that bunker that maybe those left pins, you'd say there's no trees on the right if you go far enough right. And then you have the whole green. It's one of the bigger greens and flatter and pitched at you. So it would be like a 9-iron. It'd be a guaranteed 9-iron with a good angle. I could buy that. Okay. They did it on 18. They started it 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah,
I think
there was either a tree issue or a TIO that you'd get from the stands or something. I don't think they do any more of them.
Oh, you can go left.
You guys have
no,
it. Probably, but anyway, Phoenix. Sorry.
And Phoenix?
Yes.
Were you able to secure housing easily enough, or was that a challenge this year?
We're doing the RV life.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we bought a bus last fall, and so we'll be in that every week.
Would you ever consider finishing your final round and going to the Super Bowl?
I did it in 2015 when it was there.
Oh.
I went with Michael. It was the Seahawks Patriots, and Michael's a big Seahawks fan, and that was when they threw it instead of handing it to Lynch on fourth down. And I've been a Tom Brady guy, him being an Under Armour guy, and so I was on the good end, and Michael was not, and it's just us two went to the game sitting with each other.
That's awkward.
It was fine. It was a wild ending.
Yeah.
It was good. I mean, it was fun. It certainly made the Phoenix Open crazier than it is.
Crazier.
The Super Bowl itself, I've been to a lot of games I enjoyed more. It's very corporate, and there's not a ton of true fans of either team at the Super Bowl.
Is there a team that could make it this year that you would go?
I would say more than 50% chance of going regardless, and if the Cowboys go, then I'd call that 100% chance.
Staying with Phoenix, these elevated events. Phoenix has a Monday qualifier, and seems like that might be a pretty interesting story. Monday qualifiers winning anyway would be an interesting story.
Mm-hmm.
A guy getting in a $20 million event.
Yeah.
And how much his life could change.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And just your thoughts on that. I mean, I expound if you could.
It's one of the really cool things about the PGA Tour. that's possible, and it has happened. And shoot, I played with the last guy to do it on Saturday. It was Corey Connors, I think, in San Antonio. I played with him on that Saturday or Sunday. Was he the last one to do it? 2019, maybe, in San Antonio? That sound right?
Maybe. Don't remember.
And and he won that week, and President's Cup player, and multiple tour winner now. To be an elevated event with now the money that comes with that. But back to that point, I did have one more thing to say on the what you're thinking about is, I mean, I don't think it necessarily matters your financial status. I think what's more important than thinking about the difference in money coming down the stretch, and again, I may not be the player to pull on this, but is the idea that it secures your job for multiple years versus not securing it for the next year. There's been a number of guys who lose a playoff and finish second and they don't get their card back. But the guy who won off of beating him on a playoff, one hole, is guaranteed at least 2 years, which gives you so much freedom. I mean, it's not just that 2 years, like the freedom you must feel, the difference in, I know that I'm out here for this much longer. My contracts get more guaranteed now. I mean, it's a much bigger deal than thinking about the difference in the money from that week, I think, is
all
the
right.
Status difference.
Would you look at changing that to maybe 3 years?
I don't think so. I think it's significant enough to make it, and again, making it a bigger spread is like making that purse 40% versus, because the difference could be, I think... I think we have plenty of playing opportunities. I don't think you need to look to add more. I think it's in a good spot on that front, where if you win invitationals, I think it is 3.
It is.
Majors is 5. And then tour events are 2.
All right. Thank you, Jordan.
Thanks.
Jordan, thank you.